Lord, we are so, so grateful for this absolutely phenomenally beautiful day that you gave us. You seem to do that on the day that we are serving breakfast, and so we're grateful. But we would serve even in the cold, Lord, because it brings you honor and glory, and we thank you, and you are worthy of that. We thank you for the friends that we have joining us today, Lord. Along with that, we have some prayer requests to bring to your feet. Lord, we have a friend from Crazy Faith who's in the hospital right now. But the praise that goes along with the fact that he's probably not going to make it is that it's okay because he accepted you as his Lord and Savior last night. And to that, we all say amen. We also ask for prayers for our beloved Pastor Chaz, who is not well, and so he sends his love to everybody here, Lord, but I know that you're taking care of him. You always do. He's been through some crazy things since he's been out on the mission field for so long, and his health has taken the toll for that. So, but he's willing to do that. You tell us to daily take up our cross and follow you, and that is how he's had to do that. So we just thank you for bringing us such joyful visitors this morning and bringing us the beautiful weather.
So first of all, I just want to welcome the Crazy Faith Ministry and all the folks that they help to assist with a lot of things. I talked to Lonnie yesterday, and they're helping people get their lives back together. So we want to give them a hand for that. But we have, yeah, okay. Let's give them a hand. And welcome the people from out of town. Your name?
John.
John, and
your wife's Amy.
Okay, and you're from Arizona? Tucson, Arizona. Okay. Oh, okay. Okay. So as you can see, I'm not Chaz, but I wore the Chaz uniform today. So it's the shirt with a Hawaiian theme on it. So the first thing we're going to do today is we're going to show you a video about the Crazy Faith Ministry. Our theme today is kind of Crazy Faith and the Most Excellent Way Ministry. Chaz wanted me to talk about our ministry. We just moved to Pueblo First Church of the Nazarene, and we had been holding the ministry in our house for 2 years, and we started about the same time Crazy Faith started their ministry. So it's kind of neat that God puts people in places where they're needed, and I know there was a big need in Pueblo, and the Lord sent us here from Aurora, me and my wife, Teresa, stand up. So we're both originally from Pueblo, but we were living in Aurora at our last stop. We were going to Calvary Church Aurora, and the Lord just moved us to start a ministry here. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit and then just share what I think is God's heart for today. So, Wes, are you ready for the video? Okay, here we go.
What you see, the outside is not.
That's it. Kind of was a faster ending than I expected, but that works for me. So first of all, I'm gonna talk to you today about the most excellent way first. And so good morning, I'm Arnold Gonzalez, and that's kind of the way we start out with our ministry. We introduce ourselves, and when we speak, we introduce ourselves first so that everybody can know. It's kind of like one of the 12-step programs, but we call it the one-step program, and one step is Jesus. So our most excellent way, we meet on Monday nights now at the Pueblo First Church of the Nazarene. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new." So if you notice on the video, we have many people in need of. The Lord said, "When I was hungry, you gave me something to drink. When I was thirsty, you gave me. When I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. When I was hungry, you gave me something to eat." And do this. When you do this, for my people, you do this for me. The presentation for you today is much like a presentation that would be given on a Monday night meeting. So we have a short Bible study. The ministry is dedicated to helping not just those recovering, but their friends or family members can also be a part of the ministry. Some of the ways we minister are prayer, a few minutes of sharing our hearts, and celebrating a person's milestone. So be encouraged. Anyone who is in need of fellowship, who is in need of some sharing time, some time with others, and you're welcome to come to our group on Monday nights. There's also some other groups in town. Heather's store, the greatest gift. It has Tuesday night. I think it's Tuesday afternoon. Prayer meeting, right? For the home. Is it Thursday? Tuesday morning, they meet for the Bible study, and I guess we're invited there as well. Okay. All right. So I wanted to talk to you today about God's heart, the heart of God. So the title of our message is The Heart of God. The heart is a theme woven throughout the Bible and is mentioned in the King James Version 830 times, 725 times in the Old Testament, and 105 times in the New Testament. The translation of heart in Greek is cardia, which, according to Strong's Concordance, the heart is described figuratively throughout the Bible. More than just an organ, it is also the mind, character, inner self, will, intention, and center of a being or inner person of man. So I want to look at one example of what God's Word says about our hearts and how we relate to Him. Acts 13:32 says, "And when he had removed him," and this is speaking of King Saul in the book of Samuel, "and when he had removed him, he raised up for them David as king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, 'I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, who will do my will.'" So why was David a man after God's own heart? The scripture says because God saw in David a king who would do his will. And what is the will of God? 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. So the will of God is to give thanks. So, my dear brothers and sisters, why do we give thanks to God? Or when do we give thanks to God? And you can say in everything. It's in the slide. So, what if I got a new job? Give thanks in everything. What if I just passed an important exam? Give thanks in everything. What if my best friend is in the hospital? Give thanks in everything. Okay, well, how about this? What if I had some valuable things in my car stolen, and the car was broken into, and just everything's gone when I go back? Give thanks in everything, yes. So you get the picture. God's heart is his will, and his will is that we give thanks in all circumstances. So how do we do that? Ecclesiastes 3:11 says, he has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart, yet no one can fathom or understand what God has done from beginning to end. So he made us in his image with eternity in our hearts. This means we possess an innate knowledge that there is something more to life than what we can see and experience in the here and now. So, you know, we like what we do here and now. So we raise our families, we go to work. But God has better plans for us. So what happens in the here and now is not as important as giving thanks in all circumstances. Then Hebrews 4:12 says, for the word of God is active and alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitude of the heart. So what is alive and active in us, or what can be alive and active in us? And that is, yeah, God's word. So one of the things that we can do to make life better for ourselves is to study the word. And there's specifically three things that I thought about that acknowledge the heart of God. And so his word is first. His will is that we give thanks in all things. And we learn the will of God through his word. Titus 3:3-8. So before I read this, I just want to say this is one of the scripture verses that we use in the most excellent way. And what it tells us is that we shouldn't judge we shouldn't judge anybody, first of all. And I know as family members, as parents, and as grandparents, we want to steer our kids in the right direction, sometimes harshly, sometimes with you know, a lot of effort, where we want to ridicule them, we want to yell at them, you know. Harvey this morning shared something downtown at the breakfast about his father, who, when he had damaged his motorcycle, or he thought he had damaged it, his dad came up to him, and he expected him to just hit him hard with words, and instead he turned around and he just gave him, you know, he just said, son, are you hurt? Let me see your hand where it's bleeding. Let me fix that for you. So he was concerned more about his son. But I talked to Harvey a little bit after that. He said, you know, my dad changed. My dad used to be that person who would just yell and get upset and use a straight razor belt, which if anybody knows what that is, back in the barbershop days, they used to have a belt hanging on it, and that's what they use to sharpen their razor with. And they're thick, and they're made out of leather, and to get hit with one of those as a kid, I'm sure it's pretty disciplining. You would know that you were hit. So Titus 3:3 says, "For we ourselves were also once foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving various lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another." So when we look back as what we were like, and you know why we should treat others better than we think we should sometimes. I know for myself, I was quite a judgmental person in my day, and that's before God got a hold of me and steered me in the right direction. He has shown us. He has shown us as His people miracles, and I'm sure if you are aware and if you keep just keep an eye out for what God can do for you or what He does in your life, we'll notice those miracles that happen everywhere around us. We were also sharing with one of the other members. I don't think she's here today. But we were talking about miracles. One of the things Harvey said when they got the motorcycle up after he had wrecked it, which he thought there was going to be a lot of damage, and as he told the story, I thought there was going to be a lot of damage too. He came back and said, you know, there was only a little chip of paint missing. You know, it's the miracles of God. I told a story about my granddaughter who was climbing up the stairs as a baby. She was crawling up the stairs, and we happened to be moving some stuff, and there was a dolly, a steel dolly at the top of the stairs, and somehow the dolly tipped over, and it started rolling down the stairs where she was crawling up, and we were shocked. Well, when we went and checked her, we found that the dolly had completely missed her, and the Lord says, you know, I will give my angels charge over you, lest you dash your foot against a stone. So there's miracles to be seen, and there's a life to be lived through God's heart. That's what He wants for us. He wants the best for us. And I'm just going to pull up Titus 3:3-8. That way I don't have to turn around and read it from there. Oh, wait a minute. I have a brochure. So just to let you know, the most excellent way, I have brochures on the table out here, and it kind of gives an overview. Well, it gives an overview of the whole lesson, the whole ministry. And one of the scriptures is Titus 3:3-8. For we ourselves were also once foolish, disobedient, deceived. Think about this. Think about what it says. Serving various lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. So I'm sure most of us can relate to that. A time in our lives when we just weren't happy. We were just miserable, and we wanted people around us to be miserable. Maybe not everybody went through that, but a lot of us did, and God got a hold of us. So the next verse says, "But when the kindness and the love of God our Savior toward man appeared, He saved us, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy He saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom He poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior." Before I came to the Most Excellent Way, I know I've read that scripture, but I didn't really read it. I didn't really dwell on it. I really didn't think about it, because sometimes when you read through the Bible, you just kind of read, and you don't really pay attention to the words. But the words sometimes, if you're really looking and wanting God to speak to you, you look at those words, and they'll speak life into you, and you'll see what life comes from the words that God has written for us to be edified by. That having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. We are God's heart. We are his heirs. Each one of you is one of his children. You are his creation. And he loves you more than anything that could possibly be. How do we love our children? How do we love our grandchildren if you have them? It's beyond explanation. There's so much love that goes into that that we just can't even imagine it. It just comes from the heart. And it's the heart that the Lord gives us. This is a faithful saying, and these things I want you to affirm constantly, that those who have believed in God should be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable to men. So the Lord also wants us to maintain good works, not because that's going to save us, but because that's going to help us to get a little closer to what he wants us to be. We want to get a little bit closer to his will. And so he wants us to maintain those good works in order to be more like him. He created us in his image, and image is imago Dei. We're like God, created in his image. So he wants us to be like him. So we're very fortunate that God is there for us and that we're able to be ministered directly through him. All right, just a couple more things. The most excellent way, we use the 10 Attitudes of Victorious Living to kind of, it's kind of our base. It's what we do. Now, the 10 Attitudes of Victorious Living are the Beatitudes. And there's actually 8 Beatitudes, but there's 10 attitudes that we call Attitudes of Victorious Living. And I don't have the scripture verse up, but Philippians 2:5 says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." He wants us not only for our hearts, but for our minds to be like him, to follow him. Some of the attitudes I'm just going to go over real quick. Humility, and blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Repentant, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Submissive, Jesus said, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Honesty, Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness' sake, for they shall be filled. They shall be filled. Merciful. Jesus said, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Obedient. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. And then once we get through learning how to be humble and repentant and being submissive to God, we start to do things that change our lives. That's reconciliation is the next one. Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. So so one of the things we encourage our members to do is to reconcile with their loved ones. A lot of relationships have been broken over the years because of the alcohol and drugs, because of what people have done and how they're perceived by their loved ones. And one of the things that we pray for them is to be reconciled to their loved ones. Because, I mean, without your family, you have your godly family, but without a close family connection, you kind of feel lost sometimes. And so one of the things we encourage is reconciliation. Faith. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Perseverance. Jesus said, "Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven." And then finally, once we're through the process of being humble, of repenting, and becoming more honest, not only with ourselves, but with those around us, he makes us loving servants. Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." And I know Chaz has gone over good works before, and it's not for salvation. It's not to earn favor with God, but it's to help us to draw closer to God through those things we do, those godlike things that we do. Everybody here is a servant, and I really, I mean, I look at some of the people who serve, and we serve others, and although it amazes me because people's hearts are so good and faithful towards God that they're willing to give up time, money, and work for their fellow man. And I think this is one of the things that's going to make Pueblo better. I think once we go through a lot of these processes and start bringing the ministries together, we're going to start seeing less people on the street. They're still going to be the people who want to be there because they choose a life that there's no responsibility, and that's just them. And we see others who want to make a better life for themselves. So we want to be here to help. Crazy Faith is here to help. There are many churches throughout the Pueblo area who are going to be here to help. And for that, I'm very grateful. And I just want to say thanks to all of you for your work, not only with the homeless, but with your family members, with people who are struggling with addiction, with people who have lost loved ones. I know there's someone else here who isn't here because they're grieving over the loss of a loved one. And it was just too hard, just too hard to leave the house sometimes because you're just in so much pain. But we're here to pray for you, to lift you up so that God can know, so that you can know God and know that God knows you. You're not alone in this world. We're all brothers and sisters. We're here as family, and we're here to love one another. And that's what God's heart is. So, Heather, you guys ready for those next two songs? So thanks. I just want to say there's some brochures on the table if you're interested in coming. It's a ministry to people who are recovering from addiction, and that also is the heart of God. Thanks for being here, and God loves you.